Self-love is knowing your worth and knowing what you deserve and not letting anybody treat you less than that. To me, that's what it is.
Well, self-love for me is just pretty much taking care of you, making sure you're straight, making sure that your vibe is positive. And that's pretty much what self-love is for me.
Self-love to me is loving who you are, mind, body, and spirit. And to elaborate on that, I would say that self-love looks like taking care of yourself, making sure that you're eating the right foods, making sure that you're setting up healthy boundaries with people that stress you out.
Self-love to me means making sure that any commitment I make to myself, I actually follow through with.
I believe that self-love is knowing your worth and knowing what that line is to where someone is crossing that to where you're not letting someone get into your,
your space?
Yeah, your space.
Knowing that you love 24/7, all the time, yeah.
Understanding when you are stressed, just taking good care of yourself, creating positive relationships, allowing yourself to be sad sometimes, allowing yourself to be angry.
So whether that's me finishing school, me deciding that I'm gonna go to a nail appointment on Thursday, or me deciding that I'm gonna spend time with my daughter, or me deciding that I'm gonna take a nice bath with some candles and some, you know, incense.
And your space doesn't just mean the area that surrounds you. I think it also means like your mental space, your physical space, like everything around you. As long as you have that space that's comfortable with you to be yourself and you're comfortable with yourself, that's self-love.
Not needing validation from anybody.
So I think that's what self-love to me is.
Welcome.
As long as I do that, when I decide that I'm gonna do that, that's self-love.
Self-love, defined as love of self, or regard for one's own happiness or advantage, has been conceptualized both as basic human necessity and as a moral flaw, akin to vanity and selfishness, synonymous with amour propre, conceitedness, egotism, and narcissism.
I apply self-love definitely by going on walks or going for a run or something. Going to a gym, something that brings me peace and just slows things down. Honestly, I feel women have more time and we're raised to experience self-love more than men. Men, we have to matter emotions growing up. So a lot of men don't know what love is actually. To experience self-love, that's something deeper than something you can be taught. You can't be taught to love yourself. You have to experience that yourself.
I mean, it's kind of got down, it's basically like that, really. If you can't love yourself, you don't know how to love other people. And self-love is different to everybody else, so.
I apply self-love to my everyday life. I have family values that I go over with my son every night. And that means a lot to me so that he understands how to take care of himself, mind, body, and spirit. He's 5 years old, so him just learning that at an early age, like how to take care of his body, how to communicate, how to not keep secrets, how to advocate for people in the community, how to show love to himself, like those things matter. Spending quality time with family, doing yoga, meditating, getting away from the busyness when I feel like I need to. I'm trying to get more sleep. Again, going to therapy, talking out my problems, getting away from things that don't serve me, recognizing when I've outgrown people and situations, relationships. I dance, I like to go skating, and I try to just remember Antoinette. I think it's so easy, especially as a single mom, to forget ourselves. And I'm like, okay, and sometimes when I don't know if I'm practicing self-love, I define it, I write it out, and then I start practicing those things.
Well, first, by waking up and thanking God first and foremost, and then I can go on with my day, because without acknowledging him first, there is no self-love. You cannot love yourself without loving him. So that is how I handle myself.
I agree. I mean, every day that you wake up, part of self-love is appreciating that each day you're going to face a new day, face new things. But I think that how it applies to me, I mean, as far as praying and stuff like that, I agree with that. And doing what you do right defines who you are. And shoot, I smell weed. So that's how I calm myself. That's how I get into my zone.
How do I apply? Well, first I recognize it. Recognize that I actually need to incorporate more self-love, whether that's like on a daily basis or like one week I just realize, hey, I haven't done anything for myself lately. Then I'll just schedule something to do for myself. Like I'll schedule a nail appointment in which I go to get my nails done and my toes done and do the whole nine yards. One big thing about self-love is to me that you can't like skimp on it. So it's important that any energy that you're putting in anything else, like at work you're going 100%, or in school you're going 100%, taking care of your kids you're going 100%, like whatever you're expelling all of your energy doing, when you do self-love, you honestly need to go 100% as well, like 150%. You can't just do 20% of something for yourself, because really that's telling yourself that you're only worth that 20%. Like you're putting all of that energy in all those other areas, like you really need to put that into self-love as well. So yeah, showing self-love and just applying it would be me putting in 100% and then just scheduling something for myself or just doing something for myself.
Because females are basically raised to love themselves, like from get out your hair, you're this, that. Man, we're just not really show, we're not told to show emotions or show like show any affection. Like growing up, you know, you're not supposed to cry or this, that, and the third. But not knowing, like some of them young boys need to cry to let it out. You know what I'm saying? That trauma carries over to where they're adults. That's it. That's how the cycle will be broken. Once self-love is established, the cycle will hurting people will be demolished.
Do I think that there's a stigma around how men and women express self-love? That's a very complicated question for me to answer, because I guess the short answer is yes, but not in a way that you may seem. I think that there's the popular stigma that men, they're supposed to be macho, they're not supposed to express their emotions, and therefore, women, there is a stigma, women are able to be more emotional. But when I really think about it and I unpack it, I don't think women are given that opportunity either. I think that there's a stigma saying that women are more emotional than men, which is not true. Men are just as emotional as women. I think the stigma around women showing themselves self-love and their emotions, we're actually trained to really show emotions for others. And by saying that, what I mean is, you know, taking on the load of everyone else's emotions and then putting our emotions on the back burner, showing ourselves self-love after the family's been taken care of, after the family conflict has been resolved, you know, after everyone eats, after everyone gets to bed. So I definitely think when you really break it down and unpack it, really it's almost the same. Like we're not showing ourselves self-love in different ways. And when I think about men, yeah, I guess when it comes to self-love, maybe they're not expressing their emotions as much, but I also feel like men are given the opportunity to kind of express themselves more. Maybe not those raw emotions. Men are able to I don't know, I guess be angry and the world doesn't see it as being, oh, there's something wrong with you, versus if a woman is not pleasant, it's like, oh, you know, well, you can't get married if you speak your opinion. Or, oh, you know, what's wrong with you? You must be so overwhelmed because you're just feeling this authentic emotion. And so when I really look at it, I'm like, yes, there is a stigma. It might look a little different than what other people might think it looks like to me. But yeah, I don't really feel like when you really examine the woman and the male, you can find that overall people are not really expressing their true raw emotions, because we live in a country that downplays that, where self-love is not supposed to matter. Our country has been founded on capitalism at all means, whether that's through oppression, you know, racism, sexism. And so self-love is still something new to our culture. as a nation.
I feel like with self-love, a lot of a woman's appearance is determined by how people perceive her on the outside. So if a woman is dressed nice, her makeup's done, everything is, as you say, on fleek, then she's seen as, oh, she's happy, she's got it together. But if you get some pajamas and your hair ain't done, your makeup ain't done, you know, half your eyelashes, people think that you know that you're not doing good. You're going through it, you know. So, and men, we can go to the store and anything, they just say, oh, we saw him looking rough or something like that. But I mean, it's more determined on women. Women are, their image determines in society how they actually are.
And I'll piggyback off of that. That is true. I totally agree. It is pretty much based, because society has made it to the point to where if we're not dressed to par or dressed or according to what society think we should be like, then we don't care about ourselves. So I totally agree with Terry in reference to that.
Absolutely, there is. And I feel like it's mainly because men from a very early age were taught that they kind of can't express their emotions freely. And by that I mean because they're boys or because they're men and boys don't cry. And because of that, I do feel like their emotions were stifled and they weren't allowed to express them. So along with being able to express your emotions and have those feelings, I also believe self-care comes into that. Like if you care and you love yourself, you have those emotions and you have those feelings. It kind of goes hand in hand. So basically, if they were told to stifle those emotions and feelings, they naturally wouldn't be able to express that even to themselves. So men kind of don't do it. And if they are doing it, or they do it, they're seen as being soft or weak or less of, because that's not their natural tendency because of how society sees them. They're supposed to be, you know, strong and manly and all these things. But self-care is not bias. Men can do that, women can do that. It's literally whatever it is for yourself that you need to do or want to do to make yourself feel better, to make sure you're prioritizing yourself, mental stability, all those things go into self-care, and everybody needs to do it. So I do feel like men have that stigma about them in which they can't express that in that way, self-love or their emotions. So we do need to change the stigma on that. We need to take the stigma out completely.
Self-love can affect everybody mentally, emotionally, and physically, because self-love is basically, it's exactly what it is, loving yourself. If you don't love yourself, your mental will be off. If you don't love yourself, you're definitely not going to go to the gym. You're not going to go to sleep on time. You're not going to eat right. You're not going to meditate. You're not going to take care of yourself. So if you don't love yourself, I mean, all that kinds of play into it. You're not really taking care of yourself, knowing what you need for yourself.
Oh, gosh. So I think the perfect example of how self-love can affect you positively or negatively is thinking about crying. So when I think about crying is a physical reaction to a feeling that we are having. Okay, and that could be joyful tears or sad tears, right? And so it shows us, like, to me, that emotion and how we treat ourselves literally affects our body. And so if we don't show ourselves self-love, I believe in Ayurveda, it's a science. I believe in energies and our chakras, that we have chakras that we're made up out of energy. And if we are not replenishing ourselves and showing ourselves love, we're like plants. We literally need sun. We need things that feed our soul, that feeds our spirit. And we do that by showing ourselves first love. And just like a plant, if we don't give ourselves the right nutrition, because love to me is nutrition, the proper nutrition, right? Because some love is not positive love. Some self-love is selfish, you know, in a bad way, right? But anyways, so I think that it creates disease in the body. And whether we believe it or not, if we don't show ourselves self-love, that disease is contagious, because we're just made up of energy. We're exchanging energy all the time. And then, so we actually affect our homes, we affect our communities, and we also just affect our environments in general. And so when you don't practice self-love, it's a ripple effect. It impacts everyone that you're attached to, right? And I think sometimes we're not capable of that because we're overwhelmed. But then when someone's able to show you that self-love, then healing begins. And then you can start healing yourself. And so I definitely think that I definitely believe, you know, I'm no doctor, but I believe there's some people who have actually died from just a lack of self-love. Because if you don't love yourself, you can't. You, when people are trying to even give you self-love, it's hard to receive it, right? Or if people are trying to love you, it's hard to receive that if you're not practicing it within yourself. Not practicing self-love can lead to death. And I'm talking about just the detachment to your soul, to your spirit, to life. Like, you can just be numb and just working, taking care of children and not feeling. Or it can literally lead to physical death, where there's just so much disease in the body, and then you die. And so I think in retrospect, when you are practicing that, it brings life. Things are able to blossom and grow within our lives, within our communities, within our environments in general. And I think it's like, you know, there's that saying that you reap what you sow. Literally, going back to plants, when you are sowing positivity in your life, even when things are not working in your favor, when you're still showing yourself love and practicing those affirmations, when everyone tells you that you're nothing and you're like, I am someone, I do believe in myself, I love myself, and you just keep on sowing those seeds until you see things grow, till you manifest like positivity and just things that work in your favor, that works in your family's favor, it's a ripple effect. It's contagious. And so, yes, I think that those are both negative and positive aspects of self-love, when you get it and when you don't receive it.
How can you not experience self-love if you're going on, if you're feeding yourself, it's self-love. If you smile, it's self-love. I mean, if you can have all kinds of things that you hate about yourself, but indirectly, you're always going to show yourself some sort of self-love. Now, true self-love is like, oh, a lot of people would be like, oh, well, I'm going to go get a massage, and that's my self-love. No, self-love is not, I mean, that's part of self-love, but self-love is more of a whatever you do that makes you go on. If you have no self-love, to me, you have no worth, no meaningful living, really. You might as well just kill yourself. Or you're dead to me. You know, you have no self-worth, you have no self-appreciation, and you don't show yourself anything, it's impossible. If you get up and breathe, you're giving yourself self-love, because you're going on. Every step you take is self-love.
But then now I think you're going into the aspect of more of mental health. Positively, I guess it will just, you know, create happiness within self, but negatively, I think it will cause more depression, it will cause more, you know, just a spiral of mental health issues.
It can even cause anger, get sick.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually documented, you know. You get sick, you can set off a chain of mental depression and mental problems, just holding things in and not, if you get anything that's bottled up, it's one day it's gonna just burst. And that's the problem without giving no self-love. That's how people kill people. That's how people snap. They bottle everything up, and then, you know, when they let it out, it can be dangerous for themselves and anyone around them. Without that self-love, you can be a very angry person, mm-hmm. because you don't get that release. And whether it's just going out, even if you were to just go out and scream at the top of your lungs in the backyard, sometimes that makes people feel better. You know what I'm saying? You got a quiet person that's holding everything in all day. People talking to them crazy, and they don't say nothing. They're real timid. And they get by themselves, and they're just like, ah! You know, and they just they're letting it all out. That's self-love. It's like, man, if I could cut this room. It was like when your spouse goes into another room and you'd be like, what the fuck are you doing? You know, you say you're the self love. They come back, baby, I love you. Self love, I didn't catch yours. That is probably having really, really bad anger problems. I'd say they need some self love. I ain't never seen a woman go get mad because she get the manicure. I ain't never seen a dude or somebody get mad when they get in the massage. You know what I'm saying? It's the self love is what, you know. I ain't never seen nobody get mad smoking a blunt. Unless it wasn't rolled big enough. Or, you know.
So I know firsthand what it feels like to not prioritize myself. It feels like anxiety. It feels like depression. It feels like forgetting who I am. And it's easy to forget. It's easy to let go of oneself whenever you're not showing yourself that attention and that love you need. It's easy to forget about your wants and desires whenever you're doing or you're making sure that someone else's wants and desires are taken care of. That's you literally not doing any type of self-love. So when that's not happening, what happens is you lose yourself. And then that's when every other small mental thing step comes into play. And for me, that's anxiety. That's depression. And that's exactly what it looks like when I don't take care of myself, when I don't put myself first. So no matter what happens, whether you're in a relationship with someone or if you're just a single mom with a few kids that you need to take care of, or whether, you know, your job is really draining, whatever you're doing in life and the world, it does not matter. You have to take time to have that self-love, because all of those other issues will bubble to the surface that you do have if you don't take care of yourself. Yourself is number one's priority.
Yeah, everybody needs self-love. Like, self-love is just really legit is what it is. Loving your goddamn self. Like, without it, you're not gonna, you can't go far in life.
You know, interviewing them was really, really fun and exciting. They're all completely different from different walks of life. Yet all of their answers were very consistent in some ways. They definitely had different perspectives as well. And I love that. I feel like it gave this video depth, understanding. But like I said, one thing that does remain the same that I completely agree with is that self-love is just loving yourself. Taking care of yourself, prioritizing yourself, making sure to extend that on through generations, whether that be your children. You know, sometimes children show their parents, your best friend, your significant other, you know. Just make sure to be consistent in loving yourself. I just feel like only then will you actually be able to love others. And that's why self-love is so important to me. Self-love is the best love.